Michael DeLeo, today we're going to talk about Waldorf education and science. What's unique about how we teach science in Waldorf schools and how we teach science in Waldorf education?
Yeah, that's a very good question. For me, what makes science particularly unusual in Waldorf education is that it doesn't focus primarily just on the facts, but really focuses on the capacity to arrive at the thinking activity itself that results in the facts. People go often, they go to a university, they study science, they learn what's been done before and think they're going to be asked to just take that and apply it to problems that exist. But having worked in new technology for 7 years, what I found is that the real endeavor of science is this capacity to find a solution when you don't know what you're doing, when no one has worked on this before, when you can look through all the research and look online or whatever way possible and find that there isn't an answer here. I think that the time we live in is full of problems and possibilities in which new solutions are being asked for. But in order to do that, then we need an education that teaches not the solutions of today, but how do you develop human beings that can find these solutions that have never been found before, because the context for finding them has never existed before.
It's been such an interesting and exciting process to work with you, with our other science teachers, with our physics teacher, with our chemistry teacher. Part of why we're here talking today is to discuss how we are creating here at Waldorf School of the Peninsula a science elective, an interdisciplinary science elective, including physics, biology, and chemistry, where we have portions of the class where all three teachers are in the room with the students working on solving problems and making really important discoveries through questions. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
Well, this is really the future, isn't it? It's the future of Waldorf education, but it's also the future of science. And I think it's fascinating that this is happening here in Silicon Valley. I think everyone's recognizing, whether they're in physics, whether they're in chemistry and life science, that this interdisciplinary need is really a reality. I think in the later part of the 20th century, we had a number of environmental issues where we would say develop some technology and not recognize its effects, say, of a chemical on the environment in the biological space, or where we would introduce some plant as an invasive, to get rid of an invasive species, and then introduce a new invasive species to create the next problem for the last invasive species. There are a number of examples of that in the United States. So we can begin to see that on a societal level, this idea of an interdisciplinary is a real necessity so that we don't keep falling into some of the knowable problems of the past, but more excitingly, can actually find new relationships that cut across the disciplines that would open up a way of thinking that nobody could even have imagined before. Mm-hmm. Now, why this is, I think, especially important for Waldorf education is Waldorf education has always worked across the disciplines. In the earlier grades, especially, the students in grades 1 through 8 are constantly switching from one block to a next, a main lesson block, where they focus on one subject in the sciences, and then maybe it's followed by a block in the history, and then followed by a study of some artistic element, and then back to a new science or mathematics again. Now we have this capacity where the sciences have been strong enough here at this particular school and in a number of Waldorf high schools, where the physics, the chemistry, and the life science are strong in their own disciplines. Now we can begin to take this step because it's naturally an interdisciplinary education where now we cut across the disciplines. We have students who have this flexibility of thinking and are really capable of then, you know, in some ways it's like setting a horse free in the pasture. They're going to run, and they're going to run to places we haven't even imagined. It's fun for the teachers. It's exciting for the students. And they go into the universities then, and the good professors, the good admissions people see quite quickly there's something different that these people have, something many of them describe. The oldest ones say, we haven't seen people like this with this level of flexibility in decades because of this increasing specialization that has occurred in education over the last few generations.
The other aspect that I'm thinking about when we talk about this collaborative elective is how these three teachers are collaborating to a degree where they're actually making bringing new questions that they have never asked before in their training.
Yeah, I think that's the most exciting part, because the students then see adults who are actually engaged in the scientific process. They see adults that have enthusiasm, have a body of knowledge, but are constantly walking themselves up against these new challenges. If they can learn, oh, challenges are a natural part of the scientific process, it's not about whether you know enough, it's about whether you can figure out what you don't know. Mm-hmm. And when they see adults already practicing this, where they see adults working collaboratively, and now they're asked to work collaboratively, not to just remember what the adult said, but to actually put their own thoughts and ideas, that's very, very exciting.
So what also is really imperative is at a Waldorf High School, you have chemistry, physics, biology, and earth science in 9th grade, in 10th grade, in 11th grade, and 12th grade. So every single year, all of those 4 years, the students are experiencing all four sciences.
It's not like in many forms of education where, let's say, 9th grade, they have life science, and in 10th grade, maybe they have chemistry, and 11th grade, physics, and then 12th grade, an advanced life science. Well, what happened to the chemistry in 10th grade? The students never got to do that more advanced chemistry that they might be capable of doing in 12th grade. So by taking the sciences and doing one part of it each year, we can actually develop the biological, the chemistry, the physics, and the earth science in a way where it keeps becoming more and more sophisticated. No other form of education can do that. And I think this makes our students particularly adept when they go into the university. They've had all their sciences in the past year. They're not trying to remember chemistry from 3 or 4 years ago, which they don't quite remember anymore.
What's also really exciting is how in 9th grade, we start with very concrete concepts, and then we move by the time they're in 11th and 12th grade to more abstract concepts. We really work with where are they developmentally. We don't see a high school student as the same over those 4 years. They're extremely different from 9th grade to 10th to 11th and 12th, and that prefrontal lobe development that occurs around 11th grade, that's when we bring in those very abstract concepts. And what's really interesting is how many students start to absolutely love science that you would have never thought would have loved science.
Exactly. They're doing each of the sciences every year, so all four of the sciences can be built up simultaneously.
It's developing that foundation that we talked about earlier that's so important. And I see that in the biological sciences as well. We're working with anatomy and physiology, things that they can relate to in the 9th and 10th grade. And then when we move into cell biology, they are so excited and so interested and so ready to learn it.
Yeah, absolutely. So you already have this approach where in every year the students are having some physics, some chemistry, some life science, in addition to the earth science. Now we get to the 12th grade and we have this opportunity that we've co-developed here to take the sciences and work in an interdisciplinary fashion, where the students will have a little bit more of the real specialization of the physics, a little more of the chemistry, and a little more of the life science, but then have this interdisciplinary section of the year where for, say, 6 to 8 weeks, they'll be working with three different science teachers simultaneously on a complex problem to be able to have a much more enlivened, much more living, much more dynamic picture of some contemporary issue or area of study than would normally be accorded in a high school for sure, but even in many universities. Rather than keeping the sciences in their specific channels, this is kind of moving across the different channels, so it gives a much richer and much broader capacity, which from my perspective is exactly what's necessary to work on some of the environmental and interdisciplinary difficulties and issues, but also constructive possibilities that exist today.
So this collaborative work, this flexibility, and as you describe this course, that's exactly what I'm hearing.
Yeah, and this is what makes it, I think, quite unique. Usually the students will not get this level of collaborative possibility between an instructor and their classmates until they're in their upper-level undergraduate or even graduate-level courses. That doesn't mean they're doing graduate-level work, but what's interesting is the students are working on this at a time before they've become specialized. So that flexibility of thought I've found in older high school students is sometimes even greater than you can get from students in the university or postgraduate level. Yes, they have more expertise after their university education, but they don't have that flexibility and freshness of mind. So if that's practiced now, that can be combined with the specialization that they have in the university. and develop, I think, very powerful thinkers.
And how does that help them in technology? There's so much work these days in the area of technology. How does it help them there, do you think?
Yeah, I think in new technology, it's particularly interesting because my experience was you're constantly in a situation where you're trying to find a new way around a problem that no one has found before. It's quite interesting because if you take the example of a patent, in order to receive a patent, you have to do one of two things. You have to prove that no one has thought this before, but you also have to prove that no one who's, quote, skilled in the art would think of this as the next logical step. So this idea of skilled in the art, I think, is beautiful because it points to that perceptive quality. Mm-hmm. While simultaneously, it sets the bar saying, you have to have this new insight. You have to have this new understanding, not based on theory, because then it's logical. So that's that perceptive quality. We can trace this back to Da Vinci. Mm-hmm. You know, he said that his gift was to see what everyone else had already overlooked.
Well, it makes me think about Einstein, who talked about how imagination is more important than knowledge.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And you can see Einstein in many ways, he wasn't trained as a classical scientist initially, but he had this kind of artistic eye and capacity to both imagine a different way of thinking, that capacity to take something to that kind of zero and think it up again. That really was a gift of his.
Well, what's interesting is in my classes, we take a lot of time and go into a lot of depth with a concept. And again, it makes me think of Einstein, a quote where he speaks about needing to stay with a problem for a long time, that is what brings his strength, not just his intelligence.
Yeah. And I'll build on that. Another aspect of Waldorf education, I think, is really critical for this in the science, and that is to let the problem sit. Mm-hmm. You know, in most forms of education, okay, today we're going to prove, we've proved, now remember that. And in Waldorf education, what we'll often do is give the students an experience at the end of the class that they can't quite figure out, and then say, okay, don't talk about it now. Think about it. We come back tomorrow, and we'll talk about it and try and sort it out. So because of that, the students are doing this same process that a scientist is doing when they've got a real sticky problem. They go home, they think about it, they mull it over in their minds. They wake up the next morning, as we all do, with, hey, wait a minute, and you have a little bit of an insight. We want them to practice that, because otherwise, where in a classical education does a student get that practice? Mm-hmm. Instead, it's typically done, okay, see, this is how this is. It's kind of logically based, rather than letting the student sit in that place of the unknown.
What about preparedness for college? What about the rigor that's needed to really be able to be competitive these days?
I think that's an excellent question. And I think there's two parts to the question. The one is getting into the college, but the second, and I think more important one, is being successful in the college or university, especially if they choose to go on in the sciences, which often means graduate level work. You can get into a college by kind of synthesizing a certain body of knowledge. That's one way to get in, and that's the way that many people feel comfortable with. The reality is that I think both of us can relate to from our own college days is that over the course of that first year of education, those who have simply gotten in because they have the facts slowly recognize that more is being asked of them at the university level. This capacity for real thinking, not simply remembering, but real thinking, finding patterns in relationships, becomes critical, especially in the second year and beyond in engineering and the sciences. Because of that, the universities and colleges, and some of them I've spoken to directly, admissions people, notice that the Waldorf graduates and students have this greater laterality in working through a science, but then also across the science. And not just the admissions people, but even the professors begin to recognize that often they can take a Waldorf undergraduate student and put them on a research project that often they would only be selecting graduate students because of that flexibility of thinking and that capacity to think within a specific context. In terms of content preparation, we'll find that the Waldorf students do know the basics, but they understand the why, not just are able to repeat the facts. And so this understanding the why means they often understand it within a greater context. And I've seen a couple occasions where some of the students come back and say their professor was surprised at the depth with which they were trying to answer the question. Because this professors are usually used to having the student just respond to, oh, well, it's this, you know, well, it's the electron and the atom, so to speak, rather than a student saying, well, really, it's what we call an electron, but isn't it really? And then they begin to get into the electromagnetic relationships that are present within an atom. And the professors are usually surprised, well, wait a minute, we don't see that till our graduate students, maybe. So it's a unique quality that the students then have.
Which really goes back to what is it that we are facing in science today, which isn't just to go to college, but to really do something really exciting with their discoveries and with their work and with what they're able to offer.
And I would say it's not just exciting, it's necessity.
Yeah.
That our culture and world, if we look at any of the environmental issues, any of the technological issues, any of the sociological issues, or even our economic system today, our economic system is being driven by technology. Mm-hmm. So we've entered into all these new spaces that in some ways human beings have created them. So we need people that can work across the disciplines and see things in a new way in order to really take a new stab at these problems. And my sense is the freest thinking, the most flexible thinking at capacity, I think, lives within Waldorf education, because we're still not trying to work within the fixed aspects of the scientific paradigm, but work within the deepest aspect of the scientific paradigm, which is to begin to help the students answer this question: how do you solve a problem that no one has solved before?